on your phone, the *6#6 will work on the keyboard. And also, please remember, please don't put us on hold, because a number of the offices have their local weather radio as their hold music, and we don't want to be serenaded with that. So, but we appreciate everybody joining us this morning. We had one presentation last week by Stan Benjamin. Stan's in a meeting today, so Steve Wigand, who also works there with Stan very closely, will be doing the presentation this morning. We will also be recording this presentation and making that available to all the regions. So if there's folks in your offices or in other offices that aren't able to participate in one of these two presentations, we'll have that available as well. And probably if there's a big enough crowd of folks, Dan or Steve would be willing to do another run-through of this at another time. So, again, we're hearing some slamming in the background. Everybody, please make sure you mute your phone, because we are going to record. Okay, I think that's hopefully gone away now. Okay, Melissa, if you want to start the recording, please.
Yeah, we're started. We're started.
Okay.
Okay, let me go ahead and jump now, so we'll update our slides. Is everybody seeing the first slide there?
Yes, we see it very well, Stan, so we appreciate you taking the time to make this presentation, and it's all yours.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you all for joining in, and as I think you've probably heard Stan and us say many, many times, we learn a lot of things about the models, either RUC or RAP or any of them, from feedback, because you all are scrutinizing it every day and making forecasts. So please, you know, raise any issues, and at any time, send emails, let us know things you see. There are lots of little features, and that's how we find things, the threads to pull on and things to track down and ways to make the models better. I do see a couple things. This is obviously the 29th, not the 22nd, and also our implementation is 2012, not 20 March of 2011. And that is the target day at this point. I think we're in the third week of our 30-day run at NCO, and so targeting an implementation on March 20th. Let me start by just going through, and let me also say, please stop me at any time with any questions, and I'll also stop at several times after little mini sections to ask if there are any questions about data simulation or model physics or those sorts of things. Let me start by just showing some of the domains here. And again, I think most of you are aware the RAP, or the Rapid Refresh, but known as the RAP, is replacing the RUC at NCEP. And there are a lot of things that change, but there are a lot of things, a lot of the features for this kind of short-range niche that the RUC has occupied that stay the same in the RAP. And so I'll kind of go through these. One thing for sure that's changing is the domain is quite a bit bigger. And so the one we're doing the numerical integration for the model on is this blue one here, and it's actually a rotated lat lon, so it kind of matches the maps factor stuff of the NAM. And so that's why you see these funny curves up in northern Canada. That's the integration domain. It's not being distributed on that domain. The domain I think that most people will be looking at is this 130, the one that the RUC has always come out on, so that's a cut down that's done after the integration. And then the HER domain is also on there, but we're not talking about the HER here. And again, let me note things that are changing and things that are staying the same. And you should see a slide now with the RUC domain on the left and the Rapid Refresh domain on the right with the terrains there. The model component and the analysis component are both changed. They're changing from homegrown code that we developed here for the RUC to community code, and we think that's an important and a significant change. That's really what drove the Rapid Refresh. Going from the hybrid isentropic model for the RUC to the WRF-based ARW model for the Rapid Refresh, and then going from our homegrown 3DVAR for the RUC to the grid point statistical interpolation for the RAP, and that's the community analysis. It really goes back to the spherical statistical interpolation for the global model, but it's now being used in all the models. And there's a lot of development at NCEP, from NASA, from us, a lot of folks going into the GSI. So that's why, really, we think that's the analysis to go with. The other thing, as I'll talk about in a little bit, is it has a well-developed radiance assimilation package. And we didn't do radiance assimilation for the rock because we had a pretty tight domain to CONUS. And so, but with the rapid refresh with these big data sparse regions, especially over the Pacific Ocean and the upstream part of the domain, we really needed a radiance assimilation. The domain is 2.8 times bigger, includes Alaska, a lot of the Caribbean. And the things that will still stay the same, we're running a forecast every hour, just like we've always done, going out to 18 hours, and the resolution stays the same. So I guess Stan made this slide. Just to note, we had to freeze code for the RAP version that's being implemented next month at NSEP, really last summer, even earlier, except for a few minor changes. So Stan notes that's kind of like your first iPhone. It was a pretty nice improvement. There are other things we've worked on since then that are in the version we're running here at GSD, and those are candidates for a rapid refresh version 2, which we actually hope to get in maybe as early as even later this year, probably more likely early next year. I'll make reference to some of those things, but really those aren't the focus of this briefing. It's on this first one going into NSEP next month. So let me stop there. Maybe there are too many questions. This is pretty basic stuff, but any questions so far? Okay, let me go ahead and keep going. I'll talk a little bit about the model and then the data simulation, and then we'll show some statistics from what we've seen and then some case study examples. So the model, again, is the ARW version of WARP. And for the initial implementation NSEP, it's WARP version 3.2.1. Version 3.3, which is coming out last spring, it actually took some work to get that updated and implemented with all the specific things we do, like within the radar DFI and whatnot. And so we're just got version 3.3 going for the one running at GSD, but the one running at, for the NSEP implementation is version 3.2. Still quite an improvement, as you'll see from the ROC. And again, it benefits from the ongoing community development. Some of the things we've contributed to the WARF ARW include the digital filter initialization, which is used to get quiet forecasts, and I'll show some slides on that a little bit later. And that's also what's been key for doing the one-hour cycling. You don't want to do your analysis on a noisy background field. It's also what opened the door to allow us to do this DFI radar simulation that we've done with the ROC and then also are doing in the RAP. The other contribution is the GREL three-dimensional cumulus scheme, which I'll talk about in a little bit, and then also the ROC land surface model that was developed by Tanya Smirnova in our group and now includes cycling of snow on ice. And I'll show some stuff on that towards the end. And then we were also the first group to, and I apologize for my popping up on my screen, we were the first group to test this rotated lat lon version of the ARW. So just some statistics on the grid. You see it's a much bigger grid in terms of number of points covering North America versus the ROC. Still the same, a horizontal resolution, vertical levels. It's purely sigma now, not this hybrid sigma isentropic. And the other thing, which is a big difference, is the pressure top is a fair bit higher than in the ROC. The ROC, of course, it was an isentropic surface, so it kind of floated in pressure space, but it was around 50 millibars, whereas we're up at 10 for the RAP. And that's really key because a lot of the channels for the satellite radiance assimilation have their maximum response up at high levels, and so you really can't do very good radiance assimilation with a pressure top at 50. Even we may go to even a little higher for the second version of the rapid refresh. Even 10 is marginal. Also, for the boundary conditions, we're using the GFS as opposed to the NAM, which is a switch. And as you'll see, I'll talk a little bit toward the end about we're doing this partial cycling where we bring in GFS atmospheric fields and then spin them up in a little mini parallel pre-forecast twice a day. And the GFS really does a good job with the longest wavelength features, like one of the benefits of having this full global analysis. And so the fields from the GFS are quite good, and that's been a key part of the RAP as well. The 3DVAR, again, going from the ROC to the GSI with the radiances, things that stay the same are the radar DFI, the cloud analysis, the microphysics, still using Thompson with explicit hydrometeors, and going to a two-moment rain for the RAP that I'll talk a little bit about. The change in the shortwave radiation and update to the cumulus scheme and going to MYJ for the boundary layer scheme. I'll talk a bit more about those in a minute. In fact, I think right here. So on the model physics, some things have stayed the same. Some things evolved. Going from the Judea to the Goddard for the shortwave radiation. And what, John, you were telling me that I think the for cloudiness, it did better for cloudiness.
Yeah, it handles the shortwave attenuation.
He's in Boulder now, right? He's in Boulder?
Yeah. I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Can you hear us all still?
Out there.
If I could comment, you're over-modulating quite a bit. If you could do something with your microphone, there's just lots of really nasty loudness at the top of your voice here.
Try to back up a little bit. Is that better now?
Yeah, I think so. Thanks.
Okay, and I'm turning my volume down. Maybe that will help a little bit. Is that better?
That's still good.
Okay, thank you for that important feedback, actually.
Sure.
Yeah.
And now I got to turn it up a little bit because I'm having trouble hearing you all. Oh, now I'm even hearing that. Let me try the phone over.
Because I was so much older than all the rest of the gratitude.
Okay, this is partner in the southern region. Just a reminder, everybody, please mute your phones. We're hearing some background from one of the offices. Please use the mute.
Okay, are you still hearing me at a reasonable level?
I went to a party.
This sounded good, Steve, yes.
Okay. Okay, keep going on the model physics. We're still using the Thompson scheme with the explicit. And update to have 2 moment for rain. And that does better with freezing drizzle situations.
Being a nice guy. He's a nice guy. His wife was nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, again, field offices. This is Bernard, Southern Region. We need you to mute your phones. Somebody was just saying his wife was nice or something. We're hearing that. So please mute your phone because we are recording this presentation. So thank you. Go ahead, Steve.
Okay, and then for the cumulus scheme, we've gone from the Grell de Vigny scheme, which uses an ensemble of closures to be a little more robust to different situations, to this Grell 3D scheme, which has that same ensemble of closures but also allows for the compensating subsidence to be over several grid columns. It kind of recognizes the fact that with this resolution down at 13, the convection is no longer necessarily a small fraction of the grid box. And so the practical upshot has seemed to be a little less small-scale kind of splotchiness in the convection, so we think that's an improvement. The boundary wire scheme going from Burke-Thompson to MYJ and that seems to be an improvement overall. Of course, this MIJ tends to be prone to a little bit of cool and moist during the daytime. And actually, Joe Olson in our group has been testing this MYNN enhancement, and that's a possible candidate for the rapid refresh, too, that seems to do a little better in that situation. We've also added a shallow cumulus scheme in the rapid refresh, and then staying with the RUC, LSM, land surface model, but with some enhancements over what's in the RUC. Just a little bit on the vertical levels in the model. The WRF default ones are on the bottom, and then we have 50 levels, and then we do enhance things a little bit near the surface. And we found by putting the lowest model level here, 0.998 versus 0.993, a little closer to the surface, getting that layer, it helps a little bit with the mapping to the 2 meter temperature and the 10 meter wind, so it helps in that regard. Now, let me stop on that before I go into the OBS and the data simulation and ask if there are any questions. Okay, I guess I'll go ahead. Again, like the RUC, we're doing hourly assimilation using lots of different observations, all the standard ones you see here, radiosondes, profilers, aircraft, and there's actually quite a few aircraft. Some numbers stand with just checking this. Even in the lowest count hours at night and whatnot, we're still getting about 2,000 aircraft obs, up to about 15,000 during the day, maybe averaging 5,000 to 7,000. And we are getting the WVSS humidity data, moisture data that was not in the RUC, and that's mostly on Southwest and UPS. So again, the hourly cycling, there are lots of observations that go into that. We're also, of course, getting the METARs and satellite pressure, contact pressures and whatnot. So lots of observations. A couple of things that are not in the wrap yet. The MesoNet data, there was quality control issues that we coded in the ROC 3D VAR that we didn't fully get into the GSI before the freeze. And so for this initial wrap implementation, we aren't assimilating the MesoNet data. We don't think the loss will be too significant on that. And we had to weigh that against, you know, the danger of having bad obs get through the QC. And there's lots of quality control issues with the MesoNets with low wind speed biases and the like. And so that is being coded and will be in the second version of the rapid refresh. Also, the cloud top pressure data in the RUC, we were clearing and building clouds from both the METAR cloud information and the satellite cloud top data, both the NESDES and this NASA Langley product. We found there's a high bias when we do building from the satellite data. In fact, that's in the RUC right now. So for the initial rapid refresh, we're only doing clearing with the satellite cloud top pressure data. We've actually been doing testing with more judicious constraints to reintroduce the building in a more limited way, basically more low in the atmosphere. And so we think that will get in for the second version of the rapid refresh. But for the first version, we're only clearing with the satellite data while we're still building and clearing with the METAR data. Another thing, the radar reflectivity being converted to a temperature tendency and the radar DFI, that's in the rapid refresh as well, like the ROC. There's lightning data that is not in the initial wrap. It's in the experimental version we have here, and there's even expansion of that to include this GLD360 data that may get in the second version. And radial velocity is not in the initial one. We found slight degradation of the forecast of that, but we're doing some further experiments of that, and hopefully that will be in the second version of the rapid refresh. You see it? There we go. Okay, let me talk a little bit about this radar DFI. And do you all see these plot with these curves, I think?
Yes, we're seeing them.
Okay. So this is something that we put in for the ROC years ago, and it's really an enabler for the hourly assimilation. And this is a plot of the surface noise, the time tendency of the surface pressure. And so you see without any digital filter initialization, this blue curve is pretty significant noise in the model, inertial gravity wave energy, that goes out even out through 6, even 10 hours before it really settles down. And so at an hour, we really don't want to do an update with noisy fields, because then you're calculating your innovations against the noisy background, and you tend to propagate that information. So what the DFI does is, in fact, let me go forward to the slide. We basically start the initial time, and we integrate adiabatically backwards, so no physics, and then we save the information of the time steps, and we do a Gaussian average to get a value 10 minutes before the initial time. And then from there, we go forward with full physics, again, saving the model states and doing a Gaussian average. And then we get back at the initial time with a field that has a lot of the inertial gravity wave energy damped out. And so it's a smoother field to start the model integration. And so we did that even before we did the radar DFI, just to control the noise. And you can see the difference. You see the noise reduction when you're going backwards. Then you do the average. Then you go forward. And with the average, you have much less noise in this red curve now than you actually had before. And then the further addition we did for the radar assimilation is we realized during the forward integration, we could replace the temperature tendency that was coming from two places, the cumulus parameterization scheme and the explicit microphysics, with one we just deduced from the 3D reflectivity field, and that would basically put heating in where we knew there was precipitation. And then it would also remove the heating that the model might be spuriously doing in places where it had spurious precipitation. And so what that does is it induces, in a fairly balanced way, a low-level convergence and upper-level divergence around the precipitation areas. And I'll show you a plot of that. This is just a squall line here. And we picked this because it's kind of not north-south oriented. So then these right two plots are their differences in the U component of the wind field at low levels and at upper levels. And so you see this is the difference between an experiment that had the radar assimilation versus one without. So you see a slightly enhanced, just a meter per second or so, westerlies behind the line and slightly enhanced easterlies of maybe up to 2 meters per second ahead of it. So that's the low-level convergence. And then similarly, an upper-level divergence. So it just puts that signal in the wind field in a fairly balanced way. And we've also looked at this at 3 kilometers on the Hur, and we think it doesn't work quite as well there because it's more of an unbalanced evolution. But for 13 kilometers, it seems like it works quite well, not at an individual supercell scale, which you can't really resolve at 13 kilometers with parameterized convection anyway, but kind of an envelope of the bigger convective and precipitation areas. So that's one of the things we've done for this kind of short-range forecasting niche. The other things that you may be familiar with also are the cloud analysis. And this is a non-variational, and actually the hydrometeor is a misnomer here, because with one exception where we're specifying snow with some temperature constraints from the reflectivity, we are actually not directly specifying rainwater from the hydrometeor, from the radar data, because what we found is that just inducing this wind field from the temperature tendency from the reflectivity actually will spin up in a more continuous way the hydrometeors better than trying to specify them and then maybe having them just fall out and produce evaporational cooling. And so we found that we actually went away from specifying precipitation hydrometeors from the radar data. But we do use the METARs, which kind of will get the look from the bottom, and then the satellite data, which will look from the top to try to build cloud fields. And the key thing is we're not rebuilding from scratch each hour. Because we have the explicit hydrometeors from the Thomson Microphysics, we have a background estimate of them, and then we can build or trim based on the observations. And so that's what's allowed us to keep this evolving cloud hydrometeor field. And so that's helped a lot with things like fog and low visibility and kind of ceiling forecast and that sort of thing. Then a couple other things. We do something for the surface obs. It wasn't initially in the GSI, where we will account for differences between the model terrain and the actual terrain. An example here on the right is typically in the west, for example, where the valleys aren't quite deep enough in the model, the actual terrain will be lower than the one. So we basically use the model background lapse rate to adjust to the appropriate pressure for the observation or the background, actually. And then that way it's basically a better forward model, and so it helps reduce our innovations for the simulation. But one thing that, again, that was in the rock but didn't make it into the rapid refresh is we have this code where we will create pseudo-observations, or really pseudo-innovations analysis increments from surface observations to account for the depth of the boundary layer. Because basically what we realized, in a deep afternoon boundary layer, the mixing ratio, the potential temperature are largely conserved. And so the vertical length scales in the analysis were oftentimes too short because it's hard to vary them a whole lot in the vertical. And so we didn't want real long length scales up in the mid-troposphere, but we want sometimes in the afternoon longer vertical length scales. So the way we got around that was to basically take our temperature or moisture innovation from the observations and then create pseudo-innovations up to the depth of the boundary layer, up to about two-thirds of the height. And this helps with retention, especially of moisture, like on return flow situations from the Gulf. Again, this isn't in the initial rapid refresh. We've got it coded. It's in the version we're running here, the prototype for the second rapid refresh. I just wanted to mention that. I guess I already talked about the cloud stuff, but there's the blow-up on that slide. And maybe that's a good point to stop again and ask if there are any questions on the data simulation. And again, we welcome any things you see. If you see funny analyses or, you know, any situations where bad data are getting through, we please send us emails because we welcome that kind of feedback, situations where it's not handling terrain very well. Okay, let me go ahead and talk a little bit some of the output grids and whatnot. Here's a listing of the grids here. I guess the 80 is going away, and I think there was some information that Jeff Waltz-Streicher sent around after Stan's briefing last week about how to remove that from the AWIFs. I guess there's an issue also where The forecast hours beyond 12 are not available right now. Hopefully that can get resolved again because the model is being run out to 18 hours every hour. Here's a map of the grids. Again, I think this follows the one from before where the blue one with the hatching is actually the numerical integration grid. The red one is, I think, the 130 that most of you are looking at. There's actually a Puerto Rico grid that got added last fall. There's an Alaska grid, and you can see that extends outside the integration grid. So those areas are kind of special valued out when you get the wrap on the 242 grid. And then it's also disseminated on this large 221 grid, which is what the NAM is disseminated on. That's a 32-kilometer grid, though. A little bit on the post-processing. We've gone from our own post-processor to, again, using a community code that's being or been developed at NSAP called UniPost for Unified Post Processor. And we've added a lot of things that we think, as Stan said, some kind of souped-up post-processing that we think is appropriate for the rapid refresh. One is code for the ceiling, which is an NCAR code to account for falling snow. We think a little better visibility algorithm. Again, a lot of this ties into some of the work in the microphysics that NCAR's done. And that code's also being used by Bin Zhou for the SHRAP at NSAP. We have what we think is a better sea level pressure reduction, gives basically smoother SLP patterns over elevated terrain. Again, that is something that was in the rock. And also for the precip type, we take advantage of the explicit hydrometeors within the RAP, so it's not just something based on temperature and moisture. And there's actually a bug in that, in the rock one, that's actually still in there, where it basically allows for too broad of an area of mixed precipitation. So when you have both hydrometeors, other hydrometeors present in a snow situation, it will just go to mix too quickly in the precip type. And that's fixed in the RAP, and we're actually seeing examples of that yesterday, looking at the RAP versus the rock comparison for the storm up in the northern plains. Also better height diagnostic, and we switched to the use of virtual temperature in the CAPE calculation. This is consistent with requests from SPC. And a few more things, just the buffer soundings, the RAP will replace the rock as input for the downscaling to the RTMA. And again, I mentioned this a minute ago, it's also input to this hourly updated regional ensemble. I think maybe I did mention, actually, I mentioned the SHRAP, but this is Stan noted when he put the slide deck together, formerly known as the VSHRAP. It now has this name. This is a Jeff DeMago name of the NARI-TL, which stands for North American Rapid Refresh Ensemble, precursor to this eventual full ensemble that's going to be between the NAM and the Rapid Refresh, this six-member ensemble. But this basically takes advantage of time-lagged ensemble rapid refreshes. So I think there's six rapid refreshes and then a couple of NAMs, and then basically building a little ensemble of opportunity between them. And this is work that Bin Zhou at NSEP has done. He has a web page, and so we think this has been fairly promising work. Have any of you looked at this at all? Or?
Yeah, this is Phil at the Minneapolis CWSU. We actually use the VSREF quite a bit, so we've been sort of following the progress on this.
Okay, and that's good to hear. I know there's, I think a notion of an aviation focus for it. There are some other fields as well, too, and we've been talking with Bin, and one of the things we want to help get in there is, I think, a little larger spatial kernel for the spatial filtering, because I think the fields are good, but sometimes they're a little too small scale, a little too much detail for a probability field. So that's one of the things we've been kind of looking at with them. Okay, let me go ahead and keep moving. I want to talk about this partial cycling. This is something we've implemented in the RAP, and I seem to be hung up a little bit here on my advancement. Well, let me keep talking, and I'll see if I can get my computer to advance. There we go. Okay, so with the rock, and I assume everybody sees this kind of timeline with a bunch of arrows coming in. No, I went too far the other way.
Yes, we see that. Oh, there he went back. Looks like you've jumped ahead a couple of slides.
Let it catch up. I'll keep talking. So with the rock, we just completely self-cycled every hour and we didn't really have much drift. We noticed with the wrap, you wouldn't really see it, you know, even in a day or two, but over time we had a little bit of a slow drift. And this mimicked what was seen in the NAM as well. And we think just with the larger domain and the large oceanic region on the upstream, if I can work my way back here, I think I'm back again, that we really could benefit from the global assimilation of the GFS. And I think the NAM folks did a little study of this and found it had to do with the longest wavelength features. And a lot of it with our radiance assimilation, we just get kind of snippets of the polar orbiter. We don't get that full thing, you know, over the whole hemisphere. And so what we did to address that, and it's similar to what was done in the NAM, where they do a pre-forecast cycle for every NAM run, is twice a day we run a little side mini parallel, and we'll spin up fields from the GFS and introduce them into the rapid refresh. And so we start that at 3Z and 15Z using the GFS runs from 0 and 12Z with the rayoffs. And then we also, it's an important part of this, is we'll take the land surface model fields from the evolving, the hourly evolving wrap, and feed them into this little partial cycle, because we don't want to start again from the smooth field. So keeping the detailed land surface model fields is really important. And then we'll do, just for this spin-up cycle, we just have to do a one-hour forecast to advance that. And we'll do that for 6 hours, and so that's bringing in the same observations, the same radar, light and heating, and so forth. And then at 9Z and 21Z, we'll splice in the atmospheric fields from this partial cycle into the hourly full cycling rapid refresh. And again, we didn't see that so much in a few hours, but if you looked over time, that helped prevent a little bit of a drift. And so that's been important for the skill scores. Another side benefit we get out of that is the GFS does a really nice job with the tropical systems. Put in the TC vitals and some other stuff. And so the rock never did particularly well with tropical systems, but the wrap seems to do quite a bit better. And here's a comparison for Irene, with just a much deeper system from the wrap than the rapid than from the rock. So that's been a nice benefit. And so there are times when the rock was just, it really didn't do the tropical system well, so you just kind of had to throw out that whole region of the domain, and we think you won't see that as often with the rapid refresh. Okay, let me, one other thing, I guess I'll talk about this in some of the slides, but we also went to a higher resolution SST, so that helps, I think, in situations like trying to resolve the Gulf Stream and some of the small-scale SST features. Let me pause again before I go into verification in case study statistics and ask if there are any other questions. Is everybody still hearing me okay?
We're still here, Steve.
Let's talk a little bit about verification. And this slide here, this is kind of one of our signature slides we used to show for the rock, of what the forecast error is a function of lead time, and basically showing that we get forecast improvement all the way down to the 1 hour lead time. And again, the DFI is important in this in terms of controlling the noise, and so you can get that improvement all the way down to 1 hour. In some sense, this shows you why it's useful to have a rapid updating cycle model, because say if you're out at 3 or 4 hours, then the newer model with the newer data can provide additional benefit over a model that's initialized a little bit older. So this was what we used to get with the rocket. We think even there's a little better pick up down to the 1 hour lead time for the rapid refresh. We've also done head-to-head comparisons. I'll show some of those. I don't have one for the 1 hour, but the 1 hour wrap is definitely beating the 1 hour rock. And that comes up because a little bit about we don't fit the observations quite as closely in the wrap as we do the rock. That's kind of so what we inherited with the GSI, and we've done some modifications to the basically that what you assume for the observation error relative to the background error is what controls that in the analysis. And we think actually that, you know, the ruck might have been a little too tight. The analyses fit really closely, but then sometimes that will project errors into the forecast. And so having a little smoother analysis actually
helps even with the one-hour forecast. Here's some of these comparisons now. This is rock versus RAF. Rock is red, RAF is blue, and then a difference plot in black. So if the black curve is to the left of the zero line, that means the RAF is beating the rock. So this is a 12-hour wind and temperature error. So you see basically across the board wind for the RAF, especially at upper levels, which this has a lot to do with the higher pressure top in the RAF as well as the radius assimilation, really a big pickup there. Similarly, in the temperatures, again, for the most part, better in the RAF versus the ruck in the 12-hour temperatures. And these are from last fall. Now look at heights. There's actually a bias in the ruck heights, which is improved in the RAF. This one in the upper left is the height bias, so a big pickup there. And then a pretty big pickup in the RMS for the heights as well, too. And then these are statistics just from this past January, so you see the RAF quite a bit better in the heights. Some more recent plots, and it's kind of an interesting story here because depending upon the averaging period and what we look at, we can sometimes see some funny things. So we made some fresh ones a few weeks ago and got a little concerned, but then I'll show you a little more analysis that we convinced ourselves that it really isn't an issue, we think. Let me show you. These are now six-hour forecasts. Again, just a three-week period in January of this year. So RAF in blue, RUC in red. So the winds were better in the RAF, maybe not quite as good up high, but pretty similar. Similar in relative humidity, a little better mid-levels, maybe not quite as good near the surface. Saw this slightly elevated temperature RMS at low levels, and we were a little concerned, although let me show you some further analysis that we did. And this also showed up at the 12-hour forecast. Again, the wind and the relative humidity are fairly similar in the 12-hour forecast. But this caught our attention a little bit. But we started digging a little bit further on that. And first thing we did is we split it out for west versus east. And it turns out, not for west, but for overall CONUS versus east. It turns out when we did that same comparison for the east, we did not have that elevated RMS. And one of the issues, of course, in the west, the surface elevation is a lot higher, and so where you hit the ground kind of varies. And so we think that may be part of that. In fact, we see sometimes in the way we do our verification, we actually will interpolate. We don't just verify at mandatory and significant levels. We'll interpolate from our native level output to 10 millibar increments. And so we do sometimes see some funny things around 1,000 millibars, and we've just attributed that to kind of issues where we go below ground or whatnot. So we think that may be what's going on here in the west. So we think it's definitely not an eastern thing, and we think it's not necessarily even a problem in the west, but maybe something with our mapping. Furthermore, we looked at the biases now, and when we look at CONUS, we saw this warm bias in the RAF, but again, when we looked and this is only at 0Z, so 12-hour forecast foul only at 0Z. If we look just in the east, it's not as bad at all, and maybe a little warmer than the rock, but not this big nose that we saw before. And then similarly, just looking at the 12Z, again, fairly similar for the rock versus the rock for the temperature bias. So again, we think this isn't that big an issue. As I noted before, the analysis is a little bit smoother in the RAF versus the ROC, and we show some sounding comparisons here. I know the folks at SPC look at this quite a bit, and you'll see fairly similar. Here's just one example, the observed sounding on the left, and the ROC in the solid line on the right, and the RAF in the dashed line on the right. So you'll see how the RAF will kind of round off some of the noses of some of the inversions and won't be quite as faithful to say like this moist layer. Up at mid-levels. Some other examples that you see from SPC, here is a comparison of the RAF versus the ROC, and in both of these, the purple solid line in the background is the observed sounding, and then the on the left here you see, actually let me start with the ROC. The ROC fitting pretty tightly these different inversion layers and moisture layers, even rounding a little bit here, but then just a little smoother overall in the RAF compared to the ROC. And then here's one actually where the RAF does pretty well in fitting some layers. So it's not like they're totally smoothed out. So that's one difference you will notice. Let me talk a little bit about precipitation. Again, here we think overall it's quite a bit better, with one caveat that there's a little higher bias, or maybe a fair bit higher bias, especially at the higher thresholds. But that's played against what was a long-standing, pretty significant low bias in the ruck at high thresholds. So let me start maybe with these bias curves. And this is from last spring and summer. The ruck bias, and these are basically, it's the sum of two successive 12-hour ruck accumulations against a 24-hour CPC. So there are really two 12-hour rucks in this. But at the highest thresholds here, the ruck bias was pretty low, pretty dry. The RAP is fairly even, but then it's above one, but then turns up a little more at the highest thresholds. But, and if I can get back now, I hit my cursor. The CSI, I'll just keep talking while it hopefully goes back. The CSI is definitely higher for all thresholds. There we go. And especially at these highest thresholds, it's even higher here. Now, some of that, of course, you get a little higher CSI as you move your bias above one. But we just think overall the forecasts are better in terms of probability detection and just alerting you to precipitation features, with the caveat that there will be some high bias in the highest thresholds. Now let me go to that example. This is what we think is a fairly good example of what you'll see, kind of the look and feel. So here's the observed CPC 24-hour analysis. And then this is a ruck forecast, and then a rapid refresh, and these have all been interpolated to a common 20-kilometer grid. And so there is a kind of a squall line feature here from northwestern Kansas into southeastern Colorado that the RAP did a pretty good job with. That the rock, it kind of hinted at, but really just didn't capture that. You see the RAP doing better kind of with this stuff along the warm front out in Indiana and Ohio as well. But then you do see in this heavy precipitation area in South Dakota and the Northern Plains, a little excessive in the RAP compared to, but the RUC's a little under too. So overall, CSIs are definitely higher, but the biases are above one as well. So that's just I think a feel for what you'll see from the rapid refresh. And then here's the same plot, but we have these just hits, misses, and false alarms color-coded. So you see definitely more hits across this line from Kansas into southeastern Colorado, and even in this heavy precipitation region, the Northern Plains. A little more false alarm is indicated by the red here. Let me pause on that for a second and, again, give a chance for any questions or comments from anybody.
Yeah, this is Walter from San Juan. We've had a lot of trouble with our soundings drying out after a very moist layer that we have in our marine layer over the station. And I'm wondering if perhaps you're also having that same problem, because I noticed that the model tends to show moisture where the sounding did not. Any thoughts on that?
No, let me make sure I understand. So this is the analyzed sounding would be too moist, but then in the model forecast time, it dries out?
Well, no. What I'm saying is, if you go back to the slides that you showed with the soundings compared to the observed, in the observed, it shows very dry layer of those.
Oh, I got you.
It shows a very dry layer, which may be actually an instrument error rather than your model.
Oh, okay. Yes, and that's part of why we don't want to perfectly fit the observations, and why, you know, to some degree we're happier to have not quite as tight a fit in the rapid refresh. In some ways we think that's better, although we want to try to be faithful to some of the noses of the inversions and their implications for convective initiation as well. So are you seeing, in general, you similarly don't want to see the analysis fit some of those moisture striation layers as well?
No, really, what we'd like to see is better observational data, but barring that, many times we have to actually delete the data because we know it's an error.
Yeah, and I think between the QC and the observations, and especially just the specified observation errors, I think some of that's happening in the analysis too, and it's a good thing.
This is St. Louis. On the same slide here, is the
the actual sounding here is the wrap trying to represent the lowest 100 millibar there better compared to the ruck, or we're having trouble seeing that purple sounding in the back there in the lowest 100 millibars, 150 millibars there.
Like it's a little closer, and this came from actually Steve Weiss at SBC. Oh, I guess the red dash line is the moist adiabat off the model versus the white one being from the observations, I think. So it does look like it may be a little, not quite. It looks like the rock was a little too warm in that lowest 100 millibars. So maybe the wrap is a little bit better.
Okay, this is just interesting. I know it's only one sample here and so forth. We're just curious. We're just kind of looking at the sound, within that lowest 200 millibars, lowest portion down there and so forth. And it seemed like that the ruck is showing a little better representation around, 900 millibars there a little bit compared to the wrap there a little bit. We're just kind of worried about that lower portion down there. That's all. I'm just curious what other samples would kind of show and what it would show, basically.
Yeah, and we've looked a fair bit at soundings, because especially SBC looks at them a lot. There are some situations where it will just be smoother and not capture a little feature like that. There are also some in the ruck as well. So we think you'll see a little bit more of that in the wrap, but... we've also looked at one-hour forecast soundings, and we've also looked at the forecast errors 1 hour. And while the zero-hour fit to the soundings is definitely quantitatively a little worse in the wrap, by 1 hour it's actually better. So we think that not quite fitting the soundings as closely in analysis actually is part of why the one-hour forecast is better. It's funny how it transitions like that. But we think you will see some of this, and you kind of see it up at this higher level, too, where it just kind of rounds the inversions a little bit. We don't think, it's a huge problem, but we'll have to keep an eye on that. We are doing some things in the analysis in our testing, and actually the folks with the NAM are looking at this as well, to more closely fit these Rayob inversion layers. But the thing we're concerned is that when we do that, we'll actually make the short-range forecast errors worse. That's typically the trade-off if you fit the soundings too closely, because there's just too much detail that may or may not be accurate in them, although obviously some of these inversion layers are. So I guess we welcome feedback on that, because it's an obvious area of interest for the model, especially with a model like the RAF, which is used for these short-range nowcasting-type applications.
Okay, well, thanks very much. I appreciate your comments, sir. Yeah, thanks again.
Anybody else?
Steve, this is Tom in Minneapolis. I think you just basically answered the question I had, which had to do with how do things look at that one-hour forecast time frame, just because, that's what's kind of important in terms of what goes into our local lapse analyses, and I think even the SPC mesoanalysis is using that one-hour forecast as background.
And we definitely have checked those to see, and it's amazing. Even by 1 hour, it's a tighter fit. And we actually, on our, Jeff Mannequin on his parallel webpage, which I will try to go to just to do some live things if there's time, although I see it's already getting pretty close to 11, our time at least. He's got soundings from 0 hour, 6 hour, and 12 hour. But we actually on our one here have hourly soundings from a bunch of different sites that Curtis Alexander put together. And so you can't see how it evolves from the analysis to even the first hour. And we think that based on the statistics we see quantitatively averaging, and then just from looking at them even by 1 hour, that the fits are better from the wrap.
Okay, thanks, Steve.
Okay, any other questions on this part? Let me talk a bit about surface verification. And I'll show a couple plots, one from warm season last year and then one more recent from the cold season. The warm season, again, this is a biogeographic rock in red. Basically, the wrap is a little warm, a little better, though, closer to even in the early morning through afternoon, but a little warm at night and a little warm later in the day. The rock a little cool during the day, but maybe but better overnight and later in the afternoon. Both models were, I'll show you, it looks like the wrap now for the cold season. We have to kind of separate out the evolution we made with the wrap versus the cold season versus the warm season, because we think the plots for the winter look a little bit different, but we think some of that will go back to kind of the warm season mode. Both the rock and the wrap are too moist, a minimum in their moistness early morning, but then growing quite a bit with the ruck worse than the wrap late afternoon into overnight. And we've helped that some. That remains a problem. Let me show you these winter stats now. And here it looks like the wrap has been really dead on in the temperature bias through the day with a pretty pronounced cold bias in the ruck during the daytime and afternoon especially. Again, they're both too moist with the dew point. Wrap a little worse during the day, ruck a little worse overnight. And let me say, there's a lot of modifications we've made that are in the rapid refresh we're running here at GSD, and will be in the second version of the rapid refresh. So this has been helped some, maybe a fair bit even, but it still remains a little bit of a problem, but they aren't in the initial version either. So this is something to note, that it is a little moist in the dew points in the afternoon. But the temperature is really better than the ruck at this point. There's a big issue with the ruck, especially over snow cover, that I'll talk about in a little bit. So I don't know, have any of you been looking at surface temperatures and dew points and seen anything yourselves on this? Or okay, and again, you know, as we get more into the severe weather season and whatnot, and welcome any feedback on this, because this obviously has some implications for convective initiation and whatnot, especially along with the sounding structure. Just a few plots we pulled off, and this is down the bottom. You'll see the link to this is Jeff Manikin's parallel page, which is now was initially pointing to the parallel version that he was running before the code went over to NCO. It's now pointing to the plots coming from NCO. And you can see comparisons of a lot of different fields between the ruck and the rapid refresh, and even different plots and sounding differences. Just SLP is a difference between the ruck and the rapid refresh. I'll just go through these real quickly. Pretty similar look and feel overall. This is a plot of 700 millibar, I think it's 700 millibar RH, and then kind of a blue, kind of funny contours of vertical velocity. So they're fairly similar there. And then reflectivity, I know, you know, I don't know how much you all look at reflectivity from a parameterized model like the wrap, but it's fairly similar. I think maybe a little higher reflectivity from the rapid refresh. And again, this gets complicated by how you diagnose reflectivity from the cumulus scheme, and then even what the post-processing is and whatnot. So that's kind of a funny dry field. We've looked a fair bit at the snow cover, and that's what this field is here, between the ruck and the rapid refresh. The ruck has had a problem of keeping too much snow cover. We're actually kind of coming into the season where that can be a problem again in the springtime. And then combined with that was a situation where it would have a lot of trouble warming temperatures over snow cover. In the spring, you can oftentimes get temperatures up into the, you know, well into the 50s over snow cover, and the ruck would just really lock the temperatures in the mid-30s, and so you could get some pretty large temperature busts from the ruck, and you may have seen that. In general, the wrap does quite a bit better at that, and also the ruck, it would not melt the snow fast enough, and then combined with keeping the temperature too cold over the snow would really, kind of those two problems would go hand in hand. The wrap melts the snow a little faster. We have a case example from that mid-Atlantic snowstorm from, I guess it was last week, where now this is the ruck snow on the top, the wrap snow on the bottom, the more snow still lingering. This is, I think, the day after the snow, and it melted pretty fast, so less snow in the wrap compared to the ruck. Here's a little zoom in on that. And then you can see that in the temperatures. It had quite an impact on the temperatures. Let me go back even. You also see differences up in the Adirondacks and even east of Lake Ontario in terms of the ruck versus the wrap. And so then associated with that pretty big temperature differences. You see temperatures kind of lock into the upper 20s in New York, and then even it looked down in the rock in eastern Virginia, where you're really down in the low 40s, maybe the upper 40s, touching 50, whereas here you're into the low 50s into eastern Virginia. And then if you look actually at the, and I'm locked up again, hopefully it will update. What will come up in a minute is an observed temperature map, and you'll see in eastern Virginia it was definitely up into the 50s. And so that definitely verified better. And I apologize that, there we go. So you see, and now I went two, of course. Now I feel like you see 57, mid-50s here in southeastern Virginia, which definitely verified better than in the rat versus the rock. Then one other example we just pulled off, again, at the cost of maybe a little bit of a high bias, the rat just does a better job at kind of capturing a lot of kind of small-scale precipitation systems. And here's one from a few days ago that came across northern Florida. I believe this is it's a three-hour accumulation between the rock, which really missed it, and the rapid refresh, which did quite a good job. And then this is a slightly later reflectivity image, I think, by 3 hours. I think it's just what Sam was able to grab. So the system had kind of propagated across Florida. But you see that the rat did a much better job of kind of capturing the fact that there would be some small-scale precipitation system like that. And then one other thing, this is a difference in the skin temperature plot, kind of crazy colors, but the thing to point here is over water, that defaults to the SST difference, and so you see these small-scale differences here, and that comes from using this higher resolution 4-kilometer SST data set in the RAP versus the 24-kilometer one that was in the rock. And so for things like depicting eddies in the Gulf Stream and whatnot, things that can be important for East Coast cyclogenesis, we think the RAP should be better there as well. And then let me just quickly show you, this is a little case study that Jeff Mannequin put together showing kind of a small-scale precipitation band, and you see rock versus RAP, overall this heights of vorticity, pretty similar, but just a little bit of a vorticity feature in the RAP, and associated with that, a precipitation band forecast from the RAP that wasn't in the rock. And then you can see comparison. It was not quite right in location, and this is reflectivity, not accumulated precipitation, but you can see it definitely captured, was giving a heads up of something that did exist. And as we look through this, you can kind of see a little V-model key here, looking at the 0Z run, then we'll go through the 1Z and the 2Z run, where the rat kind of hints at something that the rock doesn't have and then begins to kind of refine the location. So as Jeff Mannequin says, you get the initial concept of the event, then it kind of refines the location a little bit. I guess first it kind of builds the amount and then refines the location. So again, these aren't all always going to be right, but these are examples where the rat may pick up things that the rock doesn't have. And Jeff's got a few more clicks on this. I haven't quite figured out all those animations on it. So overall, we think improved skill, most upper air features, better precipitation with caveat, a little higher bias. The winds are definitely better. And then improved temperature and a little bit of a high bias at dew point. But we think overall, a big improvement over the rock. And then there are further improvements that we're working on here that will go into a version 2 of the rapid refresh that we hope to get in. Maybe as early as late this year, but probably more likely sometime next year. And I think with that, I've gone right at an hour, so maybe I better stop talking. And again, if you have any questions, be happy to take some questions.
Yeah, this is Robin Cheyenne. I had a question for you regarding the 2-meter dew points bias in the west. I noticed you had the slide for the east, but do you have one for the west as well?
Yeah, we've looked at that. I haven't pulled it up recently. Do you remember, John, what the
temperature bias?
Yeah, you want temperature or dew point, or really both, probably?
Yeah, just both.
Remember what they are on the west. We have definitely looked at it, and we separate them a lot because a lot of times there's different characteristics. I might need to go back and look at that. We could pull that up and send you something, actually, if you want.
That would be great.
Dew point bias in the west is sometimes low during the daytime.
That's what I was
as opposed to the east, where it typically is high during the daytime.
Yeah, that's kind of my memory too, I think, is we will sometimes be too dry in the west during the daytime. And
yeah, we notice that some of our models tend to have too high dew points for it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And I know Joe Olson in our group has looked at this quite a bit because he's been testing this MYNN scheme, and he made some plots, but they were from the summer, and I'm trying to remember.
Yeah.
But let me I'll crunch the numbers and make a slide and actually send that to you, and again, welcome any feedback that you have on that.
Okay, great. Thanks.
You mostly concerned about the summertime or
convection? Yeah, fire weather season. Or? That's one thing that's big for us, especially during the summertime.
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll try to maybe do a winter one and a summer one. Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, any other questions or comments for Steve?
Hi, this is Goodwin with a question.
Go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted curious with the switch coming to from the ruck to the now the wrap coming up, what impact, if any, might this have for the HER? I know that wasn't the base for the talk today, but have you looked at the HER and how that might, these fields and the biases and the wrap, how that's going to feed into the HER coming away from the ruck?
Yeah, and we actually run the HER out of the model versions we run here at GSD, and so we actually switched the HER to the RAP last spring. I think it was mid-April of 2011. And so it ran all last year out of the GSD version of the RAP. And we did some comparison. It's, we think, a bit better. And as the RAP has continued to evolve, it has continued to evolve. Initially, the HER out of the RAP was a little hotter, a little heavier precip and reflectivity, but we've done some adjustments. And basically, we're now running the RAP or the HER out of the RAP at GSD that has a lot of these improvements for the second version of the RAP that I alluded to in this talk. And so some of the things we've done to improve a little bit of a moist bias are now in the GSD RAP that's the parent to the HER. So kind of the HER went to the RAP a year ago and is now with this kind of a beta version of the RAP, I guess. Be a way to put it.
Okay, one more question then. So here in Central Region anyway, we are getting the HER into AWIPS. My question now, I'm a little confused, I guess, is are we getting the RAP version through you guys, or is it still the older legacy version with the HER through the RUC? Do you know?
It's the RAP version because that's the only one we're running right now.
Okay.
All right. When I say we did some comparisons. We did some offline retros of a RUC HER versus a RAP HER just for a few days last summer to get a kind of a isolated comparison.
Okay. All right. Great. I appreciate it.
This is St. Louis here again. Sorry. In August, we were looking at the HER closely in some of the cases, and I think you alluded to the fact that some of the precip cores were more intense. We're using the RAP, I think, with the RAP itself, and I will concur with that in real time, basically. I remember a couple of cases in August and late July where there wasn't much precipitation near a surface boundary, just some AC with maybe some precip evaporating down from middle of AC and so forth, and the HER was blowing these storms up quite a bit. And I think your comments are correct about there may be over forecasting of these weak forcing cases, possibly that it's going to overblow up the actual precip, convective cores a little bit. That's still kind of true.
Yeah, we've made a lot of changes. Looked at various things. One of the things, again, these are things that will go in the second version of the rapid refresh to NSEP. Even things like we were cloud building, we were not conserving theta V, which is something we've done in the rock but not in the RAP, and so you can actually moisten quite a bit if you just moisten to the temperature versus conserving theta V. That's now in this GSD version of the RAP. There were some issues with the precipitable water assimilation where we were sometimes really moistening layers. So these are some things. Oh, and the other big things were we do this modification to the soil moisture and temperature as well based on what the lowest model level of water vapor and temperature analysis increments are. So basically, if we're consistently having to dry the lowest level of the atmosphere based on the surface obs in the background, we presume that there may be some issue with the soil moisture, and so we're actually kind of trying to dry the soil a little bit, and that actually helps quite a bit, and that's we think has been a part of the reduction of some of the a bit of the rat being too moist. And then also the pseudo observations that we've been using help as well too. So again, these are things that are not in the initial one, but they're changes we've made to the RAP here, and they will be in the second version of the rapid refresh. We should say, even without these changes, the initial rapid refresh is quite a bit better, just heads up against the rock. So the RAP, this iPhone 1 version, as Stan talks about, is quite a bit of improvement, but then there are other even improvements in the pipe that will come down for the rapid refresh too, and those are affecting the HER.
And we think that the HER this year will be not quite as hot as the HER was last year because of the changes that we have made that Steve talked about.
Okay, yeah, thanks for the information. Appreciate it. Thanks again.
Yeah, thanks. Those are all good questions. Any other ones? Okay, and let me just say, please, at any time, send us emails, or if you see some things or find a problem analysis or something like that, please, because a lot of times you will see things that will give us threads to pull on, and then we can find some glitch or something in the analysis or something we need to put more of a safety check on. And so a lot of our improvements come from things seen by forecasters.
Okay, well, thank you, Steve. We appreciate you taking the time to make the presentation. As I mentioned at the beginning, we have recorded this presentation, and we'll be making both copies of the recording and also copies of the PowerPoint slides available to all the regions so that they can be shared among their field offices. So thanks for everybody for participating, and thanks, Steve and company there at Boulder, for the presentation.
Thank you.